Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us to this HABs State of the Science webinar on HABs and public health. This webinar series is organized by the Great Lakes HABs Laboratory in partnership with Ohio Sea Grant and LimnoTech. My name is Melanie Adam. I am from the Great Lakes Commission, and with us is Marianne Evans from USGS, and we might have Chris Winslow from Ohio Sea Grant in a few minutes. Today, you will hear projects from 5 research projects and initiatives in the Great Lakes region that are focused on impact of toxins on the body and the effects of exposure to HABs and the tools available to prevent public exposure. Before we begin, I would like to go through a few logistic items. We have a lot of people registered for the webinar today, and participants are in listen-only mode to avoid background noises. If you have any questions or technical problems, please type them in the question box or in the chat box, and we will do our best to deal with technical problems as they occur. Please note that this webinar will be recorded and posted on the HABs Laboratory website. Information will be sent to you in a follow-up email by the end of the week. We have reserved some time at the end of the webinar to answer questions, but you don't need to wait for the end to type them in. We will be collecting them throughout the webinar, either in the question box or in the chat box, and we'll ask them to our presenters at the end. So make sure that you specify to whom your question is addressed when you type it in. However, please note that there will be a short question session right after Virginia's Robert's presentation. If we don't have time to go through all of your questions, we will take note of them and ask our presenters to answer them offline. A follow-up document will be posted along with the slides and the recording on the webinar. In the late 2015, the Great Lakes Commission, in partnership with USGS Great Lakes Science Center, established the Great Lakes HABs Laboratory. The working mission statement of the HABs Laboratory is to create a collective virtual laboratory that enables science-based information sharing and collective actions to address HABs in the Great Lakes. The word collaboratory is derived from the idea of a collective laboratory that can enable scientists from different physical locations to work with one another. The HABs Laboratory is a multidisciplinary group with people working in biology, ecology, management, chemistry, etc., from different organizations, federal and state agencies, ministries, college and universities, and other organizations all across the Great Lakes. As a result of the kickoff meeting of the HABs Laboratory in December 2015, 5 key themes emerged as deserving more focused attention: toxicity, nitrogen cycling, HABs Mythbusters, common conceptual model, and communication. Organizing a webinar series showcasing the different HABs-related projects in the Great Lakes was suggested to rapidly inform researchers and managers of the latest ongoing research. This webinar series aims to improve communication, knowledge transfer, and create new opportunities for collaboration by presenting brief overviews of recent, ongoing, and new research projects. Ohio Sea Grant and Ohio State University are a partner for this HABs State of the Science webinar series and are currently managing 55 HABs-related projects, and this webinar series is a perfect opportunity to present some of those projects and others that are ongoing in the Great Lakes region. Other activities currently going on in the Stone Lab guests and are the Stone Lab guest and research lecture series with guest lecturer on Thursday night. Check the calendars for more details. Lastly, on September 15, there will be a State of the Science meeting in Toledo at the Stranahan Theater. This event will regroup agencies and researchers and will showcase projects related to HABs. Details about this event are found on the website. So for our first presenters, we're going to have Virginia Roberts at the CDC, who will be presenting on the One Health harmful algal bloom system.
Great. So if you can see that, we can go ahead. Thank you for inviting me to speak today, Melanie. I also want to say, Joanna Yu is on the line. She's our launch and project coordinator, so she'll be here during the question period as well. Okay. So just starting out, I don't think that this group needs to hear a lot about what, you know, what harmful algal blooms are. But certainly, you know, this session focuses on harmful algal blooms and public health. So just to really kind of reiterate that harmful algal blooms are an emerging public health issue and a One Health issue as well. They really do impact both, you know, humans, animals, and the environment, and are complex to understand given the range of exposure pathways and the numbers of algae and cyanobacteria that can cause illness and release toxins. There are a lot of questions about where these illnesses are occurring, and consequently when, you know, where the blooms are occurring. Also, when is that changing in frequency or geographic distribution over time? What are some of the risk factors for health effects? And really, what are some of the prevention efforts that are needed to address this issue? And what are the impacts of the measures that are in place? So CDC launched the One Health Harmful Algal Bloom System, or OHABS, in June of 2012. Prior to that, there was no regional or national system that was really systematically collecting public health data to really kind of systematically understand and collect and evaluate kind of what's happening with regard to illnesses and on a related scale, some of the occurrence of blooms because they're so closely linked. So the One Health Harmful Algal Bloom System was designed to be an electronic reporting system that would be web-based and a password-protected system. And we'll talk about who can use it in just a minute. It is event-based, so it's not replacing routine water monitor quality for that's happening in states, and it's not a real-time notification or case investigation system. States typically have their own kind of processes for that. It's a voluntary system for reporting to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, and it collects data on foodborne and waterborne harmful algal bloom events in fresh and marine water settings, including the events and associated human and animal cases of illness. And in this way, it will help to fill the gaps that exist in health surveillance and inform understanding of occurrences and HAB-associated illnesses, either directly through the data it collects or through partnering with other agencies and programs that have data that's complementary to understand it better. So there is a precedent for this work that's being done at CDC in launching the system. CDC currently does have a system that collects information on human outbreaks involving human illnesses, which are two or more cases of illness that are linked to a common exposure. This system, called the National Outbreak Reporting System, does collect other types of outbreak information as well, focused on food and waterborne illness and enteric illnesses. But for the purposes of this talk, the focus is harmful algal blooms. CDC also did previously have a case-based One Health surveillance system in a small number of states that we have learned a lot from, called the Harmful Algal Bloom Related Illness Surveillance System, or HABIS, which collected information on individual cases of illness in animals and humans. But that program ended in 2013. So building off of both of those programs, we have been working since early 2014 to launch the One Health Harmful Algal Bloom System. So I mentioned who can report, and I spoke a little bit about states. So CDC works with state health departments, and they work, you know, internally with their localities and other partners on public health issues. This system can be used by state-based and territorial-based public health partners and designated agencies or other partners in focusing on environmental health and animal health. And this little diagram here just kind of highlights how NORS and OHABs are linked to systems conceptually, in that NORS captures outbreak data related to humans, and the One Health Harmful Algal Bloom System is a little bit broader in terms of capturing more environmental data and more animal health data, but it does it at an individual level, which is giving us different information than we would get from an aggregate outbreak report. Briefly, this is an overview of the system, which is live, the landing page. So you can see that there's, on the left-hand side, a place where a user could search for data. It's restricted to the state that the user's in. I'm logged in as a federal user, so I see a whole list of states. There is a section in the middle where a user could review and select reports that they have entered with some summary information about the reports. On the right-hand side, there are some actions. So a user could create a new report. An administrative user could manage access to the system, which is decided at the state. There's also an option for downloading data and linking back to the National Outbreak Reporting System or accessing additional forms and resources. Just very briefly, I must really highlight, we talk about collaboration. This project has been a tremendous collaboration. Beyond the technical aspects of this work, it's really been accelerated by our CDC's involvement in the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative, and we look forward to the system going forward to inform and the work that's being done on nutrient load reductions and evaluating the impacts, helping to understand where to focus the work in those areas and how that's impacting the work. The One Health Harmful Algal Bloom System Working Group is made up of both HABs and other partners, both federal and state, that have provided a tremendous amount of technical knowledge about surveillance and harmful algal blooms, and certainly our NORS program at CDC. So in wrapping up, just want you to be aware, particularly if you are involved, if you're a state health department or state agency that's interested in the system, we have a number of user resources online where you can learn more about the system, and we have some upcoming user trainings, and you can email norswater@cdc.gov to get involved with those if you're interested. And lastly, we have recently, as part of the launch of NORS, of OHABs, launched a website called the Harmful Algal Bloom Associated Illness website. It's a public-facing site on CDC .gov that contains a lot of information about illnesses and exposure factors and how to prevent those exposures and illnesses. So that, in a nutshell, is the presentation. And thank you for including us in today's meeting.
Great, thank you. Do we have any questions for Virginia and Joanna? Please type them in.
This is Marianne. I had one question, and I'm here, so I won't type it in to make Melanie read it. What sort of products do you see coming out of this system in terms of information products or data availability or summaries of data availability to researchers or to the public?
I think that's a great question. I think there's kind of three categories that come to mind immediately. One is that, you know, it is important to make data available to the public or just in general from surveillance systems. And typically with other types of data that we collect related to waterborne diseases and outbreaks and foodborne diseases and outbreaks, there are annual or biannual summaries that are released to kind of characterize the data. So that's kind of a potential one avenue is kind of publishing summaries of the data. The second is having a mechanism where researchers and others can request information from CDC for individual projects. I don't think I really got into it, but the case data in the system is de-identified, or actually doesn't collect any personally identifiable information. That's one important point when we think about data releases. So having a process in place to be good stewards of the data and being very transparent about that as well with those who are reporting. And then the third piece, the third kind of avenue is thinking about how do we work with other agencies that collect environmental data or other types of data to really look at maybe this problem holistically, because this system doesn't collect for example, extensive environmental health data, that's being done, you know, in other ways, but maybe if we overlay some of that information through visualization tools or other mechanisms, there may be ways of making that available and understanding this issue further.
Thank you. I think that's an area where this sort of laboratory and bringing together the different disciplines could be really helpful. So
absolutely.
Look for that.
Yes, and I think that I think that with our work in through our work with the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative, it really gives us this opportunity to engage that much more closely with the region on some of these questions as well.
Very good. So a potentially related question, but with a more details to it. This was from Deborah Lee at NOAA asking if the OHAB is linked to NOAA's HAB forecast bulletins to help state reporters that a HAB event was occurring in the area of the person reporting illness.
So that's a great question. And I'll say hi to Debbie. That's a really great question and one that would be great to talk about further. It's not currently linked, although when those reports come in, I take a look at them and we try to keep an eye on where those things, what's happening. But that'd be a great kind of follow-up discussion to have.
And then someone who I presume, James Long, I presume is from New York, says, I work with NYSDOH, how do I access OHABs? Is it open to the public?
So the system, access to the system is determined. Initially, there's some overlap with kind of the folks who administer NORS and them kind of working within their agencies to identify who should have access or who can have access. We do have contacts in New York. If James wants to contact us, we can discuss further who those folks at the health department are, who we've been working with, and in the Bureau of Environmental Health, so that he could discuss that further with them.
Thank you.
So I'll give back that email address on this slide right now.
Perfect. Thank you. This looks like it was our last question. If I have others, I'm going to send them to you via email. Thank you, Virginia. Up next, we have Donna Francy at USGS.
Okay, so hi, everybody. And I'd first like to start out by acknowledging my colleagues from the USGS in Ohio and Kansas, and also from the University of Toledo. So models are used to provide real-time estimated E. coli concentrations at many beaches throughout the Great Lakes. For example, in Ohio, advisories based on these types of models are provided to the public through the Ohio NowCast. So the question is, can we develop NowCast and use models for cyanohabs, and how would they help us? Well, they may help us to focus our sample collection efforts and our limited resources at times when toxins are likely to be elevated, instead of, for example, collecting samples, every Tuesday. It may help recreational users and beach managers. It may also help drinking water treatment plant operators. But most importantly, maybe we can use models to help address the major public health concern caused by cyanohabs. Of course, that's elevated toxin concentrations. So we've been working on this since 2013. And in that study, we showed that there were many variables significantly correlated to microcystin that could be used in multiple linear regression models. So here's a few examples, and these are all graphs from data collected at Maumee Bay State Park. It's a very popular state park. It's located east of Toledo in the western basin of Lake Erie. And in the upper left, there's a graph that shows that phycocyanin was strongly related to microcystin concentrations, whether they were handheld on-site measurements, which are the green dots, or 7-day averages from a nearby continuous monitor, and those are the red triangles. And in the upper right, that graph shows the daily mean stream flows in the Maumee River, which are the gray bars, were lower in the shaded summer period when microcystin concentrations, which are the red dots, were highest. So these are real-time variables. These are used in models to very quickly estimate microcystin concentrations. Another variable, microcystis MCYE DNA, which is a gene required for microcystin production, was also significantly correlated to microcystin at Maumee Bay State Park. So these type of measurements, they take more time and effort. They can't be used in real-time models, but they really provide valuable information about the system. And they can be used in what we're calling long-term or comprehensive models. So we're moving forward in a new study that started this year, and we're collaborating with other researchers and with 7 drinking water plants. The study is funded by Ohio Water Development Authority and through the USGS Cooperative Water Program. So we're hypothesizing in this study that factors related to microcystin could be used at a wide variety of sites, both recreational and drinking water source water sites, to develop models. So for this study, sampling frequency varies based on the site and the time of year. Right now, at some sites, we're going 3 times a week because it is the height of the season. Sampling sites are the pink dots on these maps. We have sites in the Western Basin, which is the top map, and the bottom left, Harsha Lake, which is in southwest Ohio, east of Cincinnati. And then we're working at 2 drinking water treatment plants in eastern Ohio that pull water from inland lake sources. Also shown on this graph are areas where we're compiling data, and there's from a series of continuous monitors and data on stream flow, lake levels, and from nearby airport weather stations to use in our models. So whether we're sampling from a recreational site or from a tap at a drinking water plant, samples are analyzed, of course, for microcystin, because that's what we're trying to predict, for nutrients, and for cyanobacterial genes. We're also measuring all the physical parameters at the time of sampling, and we're obtaining estimates of cell counts from satellite data from NOAA for the Lake Erie sites. So that's, in a nutshell, what we're doing in the new study. And we're always looking for collaborators and new sites. So we found at our sites that measures of the algal community, phycocyanin, and pH were very strongly correlated to microcystin. But we're wondering, are they also correlated at other sites and at other lakes? So that could be something that the collaboratory could help us answer. Also, could we use variables that take more time to forecast toxin concentrations? So going beyond now casting to forecasting ahead of time. Can we combine the use of satellite imagery and regression models to predict toxin levels? And the bottom line, I think, is can useful models be developed? Thank you.
Thank you, Donna. Up next, we have Barbara Shelton at University of Toledo.
Hi. So April Ames was originally going to present today for the group, and she had a conflict, and so I was able to step in. So our group is looking at characterizing recreational exposures to cyanotoxin in the Western Lake Erie Basin. Oops, I have to click the window. Okay, there we go. So the group was very interested in occupational and environmental health, including exposure and risk assessment, and evaluating and controlling airborne contaminants. So we're interested in looking at measuring the airborne exposures and then health effects following recreational and also occupational activities in the Western Lake Erie Basin. The project will involve some GIS and spatial relationships. And I'm the epidemiologist, or one of the epidemiologists, on the project. We're in very early stages of this project, so we don't really have any data to share yet. So what we're doing is we spent the last 2 months developing a water use survey. We're very interested in understanding how recreational and also occupational use of the Western Lake Erie Basin has, what the activity is, and also how has it changed since the summer water crisis of 2014. We look to establish who's using the water, what are they doing at or on the water, and identifying locations for future proposed air sampling. So there'll be some piloting air sampling going on during this phase of the project. So we're focused just on Lucas, Ottawa, and Sandusky counties. And we're interested in, as I mentioned, the recreational and occupational exposure, specifically the airborne concentrations of exposure. And we're interested in establishing relationships to help us further examine some of these exposures in a variety of settings. So we're going to be, we have the questionnaire is going to be administered through Qualtrics. It's almost ready to be released. We have IRB approval for the project. And we're going to approach people via mail, addresses that are within, I believe we were going a half mile from the lake, as well as targeting people who are out and about and using the Western Lake Erie water sites, such as Maumee Bay, as was mentioned earlier. We're going to also be targeting some of the occupational groups, such as those running the ferries, and hoping to identify some fishermen, and I think I'm not using the technically correct term there, but we're looking to characterize exactly how water use is happening, and then in later phases of the study, we're going to want to look at health effects of water use and the airborne exposures, as well as exposure from direct water contact.
Great, thank you. Up next, we have Joe Duris at USGS.
Thanks, can everybody hear me okay? So I'm Joe Duris with the USGS cyanobacterial harmful algal blooms team. I'm the coordinator of that team in the Great Lakes. I work with seven investigators from five different USGS centers and coordinate several state agencies to answer questions about the biotic and abiotic controls on cyanobacterial HABs in the Great Lakes. And I'll call those C-HABs as we go through this. Today, I just wanted to, or I was asked to provide an overview of our C-HABs work, which does include some work related to public health. And some of you, if you've been attending this webinar series regularly, may have also heard some information about this same study from James Larson and Carrie Givens in the last webinar. So to provide an overview, like I said, our study is focused on understanding the biotic, so the biological, and abiotic, so the chemical and physical, controls on C-HAB formation, toxin production, and cessation of the blooms. This is our third full season of sampling. It's currently underway now, and we've kind of switched things around year to year. In the first year, we focused on the Western Lake Erie Basin, so where many of the talks so far today have been focused. In the second year, we actually compared across trophic gradients in the Great Lakes. So if you look at the map there in the top left, what you'll see is we have the Western Lake Erie Basin down in the kind of right corner there. We also looked at the Saginaw Bay, which has more of a mesotrophic condition. And then we looked at the Grand Traverse Bay, which has more of an oligotrophic condition. And the reason that we wanted to do that was so that we could compare across these trophic gradients to try and understand not just, things about the nutrient chemistry, but also understand the types, forms, and functions of bacteria, including the cyanobacteria, that were present in those different systems, kind of as a way to look at what's in the Great Lakes when they're healthy and what's in the Great Lakes when they're not healthy. So, and then finally we come to this year, where we're focusing more heavily on event samples and we're working in fewer sites. So this year we're focused at this top left star, which is the Green Bay. So we're focused in Green Bay and then back down in the Western Lake Erie Basin again. And we've dropped the Saginaw Bay and the Grand Traverse Bay sampling sites. So this year, really what we're focusing on is to try and capture a more high-resolution temporal sampling scheme. So the idea here is that by sampling every once a week or once every 2 weeks, we're missing a lot of information that might fall between those sampling events. And so our design this year is to try and get out and tackle multiple days and sometimes even multiple samples on an individual day to see if we can start to get past just a correlation of parameters with toxins and with cyanohabs parameters and start to get more into a mechanistic approach to understanding these. So to that end, the overview that I've got here shows our team, and like I said, there's several PIs from five different centers. Marianne, the coordinator of the collaboratory, is one of our members. James Larson, you've heard him speak. Carrie Gibbons, you've heard her speak. And then we also work with Keith Lofton in Kansas and Pete Lineker in our Wisconsin center, in addition to folks from Donna Francie's lab in Ohio, Aaron Stelzer and Chris Ecker. So the goal of our study, past the kind of simple biotic and abiotic control, some of the questions that we're asking are, how does sediment seed and relate to this year's and next year's cyanohab bloom? What types, forms of nutrients affect the intensity of bloom? So in this case, what we're looking at is not just nitrogen and phosphorus. You know, we're obviously looking at all the species of nitrogen and phosphorus, but we're also very interested in things like carbon and how the form of carbon that's present might be impacting cyanohabs, and also metals. Metals can play an important role in communication and in microbial physiology, and so we're really interested to see if some of those kind of trace metals or what we might call micronutrients, how those are affecting the CHABs. In addition, we're looking at geospatial and physiochemical properties of water. This might include things like looking at land use or land use change to try and correlate that with CHABs events. And also it could be simply things like looking at wave height or mixing events in the lakes to see how that might correspond to CHAB events. And we're really interested, as I said at the beginning, in biotic control. And this might include things like invasive or native mussels. It might include things like cyanophage, which are viruses that attack cyanobacteria. We're especially interested in those as a way that the HAB might be breaking apart when viruses attack it. And then at a local level, we're really trying to kind of get down to look more at how CHABs might be related to human health. So the findings that we have to date, and this is kind of a broad overview, and you might each even recognize some of these findings if you were attending last week, is that the genetics of sediment, the sediment cyanobacteria community, are related to the genetics of the cyanobacteria in water during bloom. So this tells us that there is some connection between what's happening in the sediment and what's happening in the water. There are shared genetic groups at all of the sediment and water locations except for two that we've sampled across Lake Erie. And it seems that there are geographic differences in that large river environments, in particularly the Detroit River and the Maumee River, seem to affect the cyanobacteria community that's in the sediment in the springtime. And if you look at this plot that we've got in the upper right-hand corner here, you see where the arrows are pointing. The first arrow points at the Detroit River, and notice that it has barely any microcystis in the sediment. The second arrow points sample collected near the Toledo water intake, and you'll notice that that has a great deal of microcystis in the sediment, but it doesn't have any Cinococcus, which is typically prevalent across the Great Lakes. So we're trying to understand why those differences occur in these different locations around the Great Lakes. In addition, we found that HAB conditions generally followed mixing events, and we likely think that that's a response to dependence on nutrient availability. So mixing stirs up bottom sediments, releases more nutrients into the system, and creates more the potential for growth and also the potential for toxin production. And finally, we've noted that the growth of secondary consumers like native mussels and the availability of important fats or lipids in the Western Basin seems to be centered around the Maumee Bay. So we have to remember that Maumee Bay isn't just kind of introducing nutrients and there's negative consequences. We also see greater productivity in the secondary producers like native mussels in that same area as well. So to get into this year and what our approach is that's related to health, so we're working with the Monroe County Health Department. We're partnered with the Michigan Department of Health and Human Services. And we're also kind of working with the state park at Sterling State Park. So if you look at this map to kind of orient you to where you are, we have down here the channel that comes out along the bottom is actually the River Raisin draining into Lake Erie. So what you'll see on the map there is that I have fixed open lake station. So that is actually one of the sampling sites that we've been working on for the past 3 years. And we'll do routine monitoring there about every 2 weeks. But notice that I also have a dot that says intensive monitoring that's much closer to shore. That is going to in focus, that sampling is going to in focus on a more intensive collection that will be over a 7-day period with temporal resolution that we hope to get between 2 and 4 hours. So we'll be collecting samples basically every day, every couple of hours for an entire week. And the idea is we'll also be running continuous sondes that are measuring parameters like pH and specific conductance and turbidity. We'll look at the pigments like phycocyanin and chlorophyll A. And then we'll also measure with kind of what I would call lower resolution or lower specificity tests, things like ortho-P and ammonia. We'll collect samples for toxins that we store. We'll collect samples for qPCR that we'll store. We'll collect samples for metagenomics so that we can look at the structure and function of the bacterial community that's changing rapidly through time. And we'll also look at time-of-flight mass spectrometry. Time-of-flight allows you to look at the individual products that are related to toxin formation. So we can start to get more into this mechanistic approach to how are the toxins being formed at this level. Now, all of this data, both the routine monitoring data at our fixed site and this local intensive monitoring data, we're then going to work with the Monroe County Health Department and MDHHS to correlate back to any symptomatic reporting that's done in that county at that health department. So again, this is a kind of a first cut to start to get at the question that how does the environmental data that we're collecting relate to the actual human health data that's being collected at the health department. And so that kind of leads to the final slide here, which is, you know, how do we see that things could be improved? Well, and how can the collaboratory help? Well, I think that one of the big things is the final point there, and that's to pair environmental data with health data. And that shouldn't just be for humans. It should also be, I think, for wildlife. Because we need to start putting these data sets together to even begin to understand the potential linkages. So it's really good to hear that that's being done down in Ohio, and you know, we hopefully will take a kind of a similar stab at it up in Michigan. And then I guess the final two things is that I think we need to understand not just the cyanobacteria in the open lake, but also the heterotrophic bacteria. There seems to be a very dynamic interaction between the cyanos and the heterotrophs that are out there, so the kind of non-cyanobacteria that are present in the lakes. And especially we want to see if those heterotrophic bacteria or selected cyanobacteria are kind of setting the stage for the bloom to take place later on in the season. And then I think the final thing is kind of where I started, which is to say that we need a more mechanistic view of the changes that are happening and of how toxins are being produced and what triggers those toxins. And the only way that we can do that is to really start to get at a finer time scale and then look in more detail at some of the congeners of the microcystins and start to look at the products that the bacteria are using to build the microcystin toxins so that we might understand how the environmental and physical conditions change and how that then relates to the production of microcystin in the Great Lakes. And that's it for me.
Great. Thank you, Joe. Yep. Up next, we have Rebecca Coleman at the CDC.
Okay, does that look right?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Hi, everyone, and thank you for your time. I'm Rebecca Coleman at the Emergency Response Branch at CDC in Atlanta, and I'm just going to give a brief review of our work concerning clinical analyses and human exposures to algal toxins. We have multiple ongoing projects to identify human exposures to algal toxins. Our current capabilities include confirmation of exposures to saxitoxin and neosaxitoxin, gynotoxins 1 through 4, and tetrodotoxin in urine using various detection methods, which I'll go over in a few minutes. We have also detected some of these compounds in animal urine samples, which I'll talk about later. We are currently developing methods for the detection of multiple microcystins and domoic acid in biological matrices as well. This is a summary of the approaches we use to clean up biological samples to detect these toxins. The first is a traditional solid phase extraction, or SPE, using a cartridge with multiple conditioning and washing steps, concentration through evaporation, reconstitution of a sample, and separation and detection using liquid chromatography and tandem mass spectrometry. The second line is a streamlined version of the first using online SPE, which greatly reduces analyst preparation time and eliminates the need for concentration and reconstitution, which generally results in improved sensitivity because we aren't losing sample at those steps. A third process we're exploring is antibody magnetic bead capture followed by LC tandem mass spec, which has the potential to improve sensitivity because it uses select antibodies raised to specific toxins to extract as much of the toxin as possible from the matrices. We have successfully used these methods to confirm exposures in humans to paralytic shellfish toxins. One such example was published in the MMWR in 2011, where multiple people were exposed after eating contaminated shellfish, and urine was collected and shipped to CDC for analysis. This data was critical in pinpointing the responsible toxins and supporting warnings disseminated by area health departments about the consumption of the recreationally collected shellfish. In terms of collaboration, we just want to suggest that if algal toxin exposure is suspected, given those typical symptoms of numbness and GI distress and paralysis, et cetera, after consumption of shellfish, collect samples if possible and do so as quickly as possible. There's the graph on this page. You can see the general excretion timeline. The toxin doesn't stay in the body for long. And we don't know everything about metabolism and excretion, but evidence suggests that we do need samples from within at least the 24 hours after exposure. For storage and shipping, try to freeze urine and plasma at minus 20 degrees Celsius or lower, but do not freeze blood if that's all that gets collected. Just make sure it stays cold until it gets where it's going. And also take full advantage of the online reporting systems that have already been talked about today, such as the National Outbreak Reporting System and the new One Health Harmful Algal Bloom System. These communications are going to be crucial in the sharing of information and data on these types of exposures. And that's really all I have. Thank you for your time.
Great, thank you. All right, if you have any questions, please use the question box or the chat box. Right now, all our panelists are still here. Just please mention to whom you're addressing your question.
I had a quick question for Rebecca while we're waiting for others. Do you have a timeline for when the microcystin test will be available for use?
Not one that I could really give you with a lot of confidence. I can put you in touch with the people who are working directly with it if you'd like.
I was just thinking, like, 1 year, 5 years, 10 years? Or you're not even sure on that?
No, I'm not. I don't work directly with that, but it's going. It's going well. But
that's good to know.
Sorry.
Rebecca, we have another question for you.
Okay.
Why can we freeze serum but not freeze blood?
It has to do with lysing of the whole cells. It's just always been a guideline in our lab. If you're saving whole blood, you don't want to freeze it. I believe lysing is the main point.
All right, thank you. Do we have any other questions? Rebecca, again, I guess. I have a question from James Long. Who can I contact about the microcystin urine assay?
If you'll email me, I don't even think I put my email on there. Is our contact information shared anywhere on there, Melanie?
I will check right now.
The main researcher is out of town right now, but I can definitely get you in touch with her.
All right. Well, it's not on the PowerPoint, so if you want to send that to me, I can add it in.
Okay.
So we can share with everybody.
Okay, I'll do that. I don't know if that's the easiest way.
I had a question for Barbara.
Yes.
I was a little confused by, so are you looking for specifically for evidence of airborne exposure to microcystin, or is it airborne exposure to things that come from the lake in general? Are there other previous studies that show that microcystin can cause human health effects through airborne contamination?
I'm not sure if there is research that it can cause human effects through airborne contamination, but there is research that shows that there are low detectable levels of microcystin that can be detected in aerosols.
Okay.
So that's one piece. Of what we're looking at, but we also want to establish the main piece of this part of our research is establishing who are the users of the water and how are they using it. So I guess those are the two pieces there. Does that answer your question?
I think so, yeah. I was just thinking in terms of that there are, you know, a number of chemicals of natural origin, of anthropogenic origin in the lake that could be present in aerosols, and that from an epidemiology perspective, measuring, you know, exposure to lake aerosols and then looking at health effects could potentially bring up health effects from a number of different sources, another number of different chemicals.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think right now, April and Mike Valagoski, they're the researchers who are going to be doing the sampling. Unfortunately, April wasn't able to make the call today, so she probably would have been able to answer your question a little bit more thoroughly. But I think microcystin has been the main focus of this grant, but obviously we need to look at other, not any health effects we look at are coming from the microcystin specifically.
Thank you. I'm looking forward to your results.
Thank you.
It's going to be a really interesting study. Good. Having no other questions in the chat box, if you have any, just email them. We will forward them to the right people. I'd like to thank all of our speakers today for presenting in this webinar, and thanks everybody for your participation. Please take a minute to fill out our survey at the end of the webinar to tell us how to improve for the next one. As mentioned
mentioned previously, we will be posting slides and the recording on the website by the end of the week. Don't forget to register for our next webinars. The next one will be on HABs blooms monitoring and forecasting on Thursday, August 11th from 1 to 2 p.m. And stay tuned for the next days and topics. Thank you for attending and have a nice day.